Gee, webinars, technology challenges, it's fantastic, isn't it? Good afternoon and welcome to this session on the future of the project management profession. My name's Paul Major and I'm your host there this afternoon. We're going to have a chat and I'm going to share some thoughts and hopefully get some feedback from you on the future of the project management profession, something that's really important to me. I'm passionate about what the future of our profession is, and I'm actually passionate about what we do as a profession. What is our role? What are we here to do? What can we add to society? What can we add to the world around us? So over the next 45 minutes to an hour, we're going to share some thoughts and some ideas together. I would normally do a sound check at this stage, which actually is what I did about 10 minutes ago, and you all came back and said you couldn't hear me. So hopefully when I do the sound check this time, you'll come on and say, yeah, we can hear you brilliantly, Paul. Yeah, and I'm getting some comments through to that effect. Fantastic. So one thing you could do for me, this is a global profession. If you're signed into this webinar and are joining us from somewhere outside of the UK, could you just ping us a question or a chat comment just to let us know where you're from? That would be awesome, because then it would be really interesting for us to know which parts of the world our audience is coming from. So, just in terms of a quick introduction to myself, my name's Paul Major. I've spent probably half of my life, a little bit more than half of my life, working in large corporates. Everything from finance to operations to sales, marketing, organizational change. And a lot of that I did through personal heroics. Hi to the USA. I see someone signed on from Michigan. Been there a lot. Used to work in automotive. Did a lot of work in Ann Arbor. One of the things I used to find when I was delivering change for organizations was it was broadly reliant on what I think of as personal heroics. It was about the team that we built around us and doing some fantastic stuff together. At the end of one of the sessions, one of the changes that I was delivering, I got introduced to some guys called project managers who were there to help me with the next strategic change project we took on. And frankly, this was sort of mid-90s. I'd never come across project managers before, strange though that may seem. And rather, I was rather suspecting that some people were going to walk into the room that had two heads and spoke a very alien language. And I was quite surprised when these guys and girls actually started talking to me in business language. And they shared with me some approaches and some techniques that helped us to deliver our business changes far more successfully than we had before, brought some structure, made it less reliant on personal heroics and more reliant on a structured, considered process. And that kind of changed my life, really. It's a bit of probably of a sad epiphany moment, but it was an epiphany moment for me. And since then, I've spent the last 12 years, and I know you'll look at that picture and think, gee, this guy must have started work when he was about 5, because there's no way he could have had 30 years at work and still look like that. You don't have to make any comments on that particular one if you don't want to. But it brought about a change, and I've spent the last 12 years working in this project and program and change management space, working quite closely with the APM, part of the Corporate Members Advisory Group here. We sponsor, founded two organizations that support the delivery of change through project control solutions and change leadership and facilitation. And through one of those organizations, we also sponsor APM's Program of the Year Award. So I've kind of spent a lot of my recent life talking projects and programs, and particularly talking to people about how they more effectively deliver those or run those projects and programs to deliver real legacy and real outcomes. So that's enough about me. I don't want to spend much time talking about me today. What I'd like to talk about is the future of our profession. Just in terms of the sort of areas that I'm going to cover this afternoon, I'm going to talk a little bit about how did we get here, share some thoughts about that. Seemed like a good place to start. I'm going to share some thoughts around what I think is happening in the world around us. And then as best as we can on a webinar, I'm actually going to try and get some interaction going with yourselves to understand actually what do you think the future of our profession is. I'm going to share some ideas then around what I think about the future of our profession is about, and I'm going to share some thoughts around why I think we absolutely have to change and change our approach and change the way we're doing things. And I'll talk a little bit about what can we do differently. What are the sort of changes that we could go back and make tomorrow in our work and in our places where we exercise our skills? Now, this is my first bit of webinar interaction, because when I do these sessions, if any of you have been to one of my sessions over in the UK or the US, then you know that we have a kind of a unique way of starting these sessions off. So what we do at the beginning of a session when we're doing this, just to make sure everyone's engaged and is part of the conversation, we have a team hoo-ha, where we all basically on the count of three, thanks for the comment from Ashok saying I'm looking young. I'm really enjoying that one. On a count of three, we do a team hoo-ha. We did this in the Queen Elizabeth Centre probably a couple of years ago. There's about 400 people in the room around syndicate tables, and our table did the team hoo-ha, and the entire room suddenly went silent. It was amazing. You could hear a pin drop. And then there was a rapturous, spontaneous round of applause just because we'd done our hoo-ha, and we all felt really good about ourselves. So what I'd like to do is we're going to do a team hoo-ha. Now, you may be feeling that you can't, sitting in your office where you are in the moment, in your cube, in the middle of a big room, you may not feel that you can do a big, loud hoo-ha. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a virtual hoo-ha. So get your fingers ready on the keyboard. And I'm looking at my feedback panel, and what I'm expecting is I'm going to count to three, then we're going to do a hoo-ha, and I'm expecting my feedback panel to light up with all of you joining in with the team hoo-ha. Are you up for that? Let's go for it. One, two, three, hoo-ha! Way! Wow, he's gone mad. Fantastic. Oh dear. My glamorous assistant Colin on my left is rapidly trying to capture all of those hoo-ha's. Awesome. That's the best, that's probably the most feedback he's had coming through his feedback monitor for any of these webinars that he's done. That's great. You also have an opportunity at any time during this presentation. You are now qualified hoo-ha-ists. So you have an opportunity when you think something is just, yeah, absolutely nailed on right, I really want to raise a flag to say that's ever so good, you have an opportunity to request a team hoo-ha. And I and all of your colleagues around the world will do a hoo-ha with you. So you now are authorized to do that. You are suitably qualified. Okay. How did we get to where we are today? That's my first question. So previously in project management, just in case you missed the earlier episodes, they are probably available on an iPlayer near you. Other devices are available. I thought I'd put this together. I think project management started probably over 4,000 years ago, and there were maybe some guys and girls around who, you know, there wasn't much going on in the IT world, so there weren't many IT projects to manage, and so they sort of scouted around and thought, what can we do to utilize our project management skills? And there was a couple of half-decent construction projects happening, you know, things like the pyramids and the Great Wall of China, and that's probably the place where our profession actually started. It was an interesting place to be a project manager. Stakeholder management was quite challenging. If you didn't deliver your project on time or indeed to the stakeholder expectations, it tended to have an impact not just on your career but on your life expectancy. So I actually think not a lot happened for about 4,000 years after then. Until we got into the end of the 19th century, start of the 20th century, and we started what I think of as the exploring phase, a period of maybe 90 years where after the industrialization of our societies, we started to see some major infrastructure type projects happening, like the US Railroad is often quoted as one of the first real examples of modern project management. And we started to see some knowledge being captured around things like Gantt and those sort of capabilities or tools or approaches being surfaced as ways of thinking about how we organized ourselves around projects. We then went into, I think, quite a rapid period of evolution. I think of 15 years maybe around the 60s as the forming stage. There were some organizations came about like the IPMA, the PMA, PMI, and even our own APM was founded. People getting together and saying, you know, we're doing kind of similar things here. I think that there's something in this project management conversation and language and skill set. Let's get together and start sharing and seeing if we can organize ourselves. So that was the forming years. And then there was the adapting years, another 15 years maybe, where we started to try and quantify and capture the knowledge that we had. and we see the first version of Prince published in 89. We see Goldratt back in 84 talking about stuff like the goal, which was based on some manufacturing supply and demand bottleneck theory conversations. We have Pimbok produced as a white paper and then published in 96. So we're starting to quantify and form the knowledge and data that we have. And then accelerating even further, it gets busier as we get closer to today's date. The last 10 years, I think, have really been about defining. We've just published Body of Knowledge version 6, I think, just before Christmas. We've had various publications that have looked at things like, let's move from prints to managing successful programs, to the management of portfolios. We've got Pimbok in various versions. And it seems to me that we spent an awful lot of time, again, capturing knowledge and reworking knowledge, defining knowledge, codifying knowledge. So we've been on a very rapid journey over these last, particularly over the last maybe 40 years. I'll link you to a video. All of these slides will be available after the session, and included in the slide deck will be some links to some videos I do when I use this presentation, when we do this presentation live. And one of those is the one celebrating 40 years of APM, and it's fascinating just to look at what's happened in 40 years since the APM was formed and the sort of things that have changed in our world. So in terms of how do we get here, a quick history lesson, 4,000 years of project management, 40 years of forming, adapting, and defining standards, and codifying knowledge, quantifying what it is we do, putting it in documents that we can not just share with people, but we can train on, we can certify ourselves in. So if that's what's been happening in the project management world, I wonder what's been happening in the world around us. Part of what's the project management conversation has also seen a big increase in membership of project management associations. So at the time that we've been doing all of this sort of codification, if you looked at what happened, for example, with the APM, the membership in the last 10 years has doubled. So it took broadly 30 years to get 10,000 members. It took another 10 years to double that to 20,000 members. So suddenly this project management conversation is becoming very current. It's becoming very noticeable. We're beginning to see people actually acknowledge that project management exists. Now, sometimes that's just because they watch The Apprentice, and there's a particular variation of project management that is espoused on The Apprentice. But there's a general recognition and knowledge and awareness of what project management is all about. One thing that I think changed last year, which was a fundamental change in our profession, and particularly in terms of the recognition of our profession, was a little event that happened in the East End of London and around the rest of the country as well, and that was the Olympics. For the first time, we actually had column inch and press saying how good project management was, how effective project management was, and how actually project management had added real value to our society, to the people in our society, to our workplace. This is a picture of the team from the ODA that were at the annual awards that I mentioned earlier. One of my colleagues is there presenting them with the Program of the Year award. They actually cleaned up three awards at the APM awards last year. It's really memorable. But it's just a recognition that one of the most complex programs that had been laid on in modern times in the UK actually worked. It succeeded. And a lot of the plaudits went to the project team and their ability to use project management approaches and disciplines to actually enable something as spectacularly successful as the Olympics to be achieved against all of the challenges and complexity involved. So we find ourselves at the end of last year in a place where our profession has grown rapidly, particularly over the last 10 years. Its awareness has grown, and it's changed from an awareness that maybe you could argue was broadly negative to an awareness that actually is broadly positive. We have something to add. I think that presents a huge challenge for us in terms of now we have that awareness, how do we use that? What do we do with our profession? And that's really where I ask the question of where does the future of our profession lie? So, at the same time as this is happening, a lot's changing in the world around us. I'm just going to show you a short video just to highlight some of the things that are changing in the world around us. This does normally have a nice soundtrack over it, and when you get the links to this video, which is a publicly available video, you'll be able to listen to that soundtrack. But just for the next 3 minutes, I'd like you to hum a suitably upbeat rhythm and tempo to yourself whilst I play this video. So, what does it all mean? This really cool soundtrack. Whilst that was on, I did you the favour of not singing to you while it was going. I think she's certainly grateful for that. The challenge is that in our world around us, life is moving on much, much more quickly than we could probably ever imagine or have imagined. The world is not, it's not just that the world is changing, that's kind of a very easy thing to say, but the scale of the change, the pace of the change, and the nature of the change is phenomenal. Far greater probably than our ability to cope with at the current time. That video is probably a couple of years out of date now, and actually a lot of the stats have moved on even further. What makes me feel really great though is that I don't know if you spotted it, there's a comment or a stat in there saying that for someone studying a technical degree, by the fourth year, they will have half of what they did in their first year or two will be irrelevant because the technology is moving on so quickly. That's scary, but it's also slightly reassuring because I've got a son who's at university at the moment, and I'm convinced that he spent most of his first year in a semi-drunken stupor. So the fact that nothing that he had to learn during that first year is relevant to the rest of his studies or life is actually, as a parent, reasonably reassuring. If that's what's happening in the world around us, then what I wanted to think about is what the future looks like for our profession, and particularly, what do you think the future looks like for our profession? So, we've kind of done a brief history lesson on the profession. We've looked at what's happening in the world around us, and I want to think about what you think the future of the profession might hold for us in that context. To help me do that, I'm going to introduce three friends of mine. I've got Susan. Susan's a dreamer. I've got Chuck. Chuck's a realist. And I've got this couple of characters here. Anyone who's online, ping me back and tell me the name of those two wonderful gentlemen, if you can remember from your childhood. And we're going to do just a little exercise that was first done by Walt Disney, actually, as part of some of the stuff he did with his management team, where we allow people to think out of their normal persona. So we allow them to think, well done, John, Ian, no, Dave, I think you got that one wrong. Ed, they're your heroes. Awesome. So Andrew, yeah, oh, getting some lots of good answers in here. So they're called the critics are called Statler and Waldorf from the Muppets, and they're going to help us in this process. We're going to be allowed to think outside of the way we normally think. So what I'm going to ask is if your surname starts with the letter G or A through to G, so A, B, C, D, E, F, G, then I'm going to ask you to be a dreamer. So if your surname starts with the letter from A to G, I'm going to ask you to be a dreamer. And what I want you to do is I want you to think about the future of the project management profession from a dreamer's point of view. And I want you to think, imagine what I would really like for this profession, or what I really think this profession would be like. It would be great if. And I want you to just come up with one statement as a dreamer of what you think the future of the project management profession might be. And put a time frame on it. Say it's 5 years' time, 5 to 10 years' time. Just a single statement. The beauty of this role is you get to remove boundaries. So I realize that some of you may well be dreamers in your everyday life, but today you're going to be authorized to be a dreamer. So for those of you whose surname starts with the letters A through to G, you be a dreamer. And I just ask you now, while I'm talking, just to jot down on the chat section, the question section of your panel, one thought around what the future of the profession might look like from a dreamer's point of view. For those of you whose surnames start with H through to P, I want you to be realists. Now, this should be pretty easy for project managers, but again, I'm going to authorize you to be a realist. And I want you to think in the context of my experience tells me. The evidence suggests, being a project manager, I'm a pragmatist. And actually, I'm going to remove emotions from this conversation. I'm going to tell you realistically what this profession is going to be like in 5 to 10 years' time. So, if your surname starts with H through to P, just one statement that you think from a realist's point of view will tell you what the future, or would describe what the future of the profession would be like. So you start writing those now as well. Getting some stuff coming from the dreamers. Thanks, Stuart. Thanks, Derek. Realist, you can start writing now. And then finally, if your surname starts with Q, or more possibly R onwards in the alphabet, then I'm going to authorize you to be a critic. Now, for most of us, we're never at all critical, are we? So you are now authorized to be as critical as you want. And your mindset is, I doubt that this will ever happen. You don't really think that the profession would be, I'm really skeptical that the profession would ever achieve. And I want you to remove optimism. So you are authorized to remove optimism, and you are authorized to talk about and make a statement from a critic's point of view around what you think the future of the project management profession would be like. So I'm just going to, hopefully you've started writing that already. I'm getting loads of stuff through. I'm going to pick some of it and read it back. But you critics start writing, and I'm just going to give a minute or two just for the critics to catch up. And then I'll just pick some of this stuff out, and we'll get a bit of a flavor of from this audience we've got on the webinar, what you think the future of the profession looks like from a dreamer, a realist, or a critic's point of view. So just a moment of silence, or a minute of silence, whilst the critics catch up, and then I'll feedback some of the comments. Okay, lots of great feedback. This is awesome. I will see if we can capture this, and we'll recirculate this stuff maybe on the blog, so you can see the sort of the breadth. We won't throw any names up there, but we will throw up the comments. So just picking a few things out from the dreamers. First one from Stuart. Yeah, all industry bodies come together. I dream that all the industry bodies would come together and join together to become one. That's a view from a dreamer. Another one, this one's come up a lot actually. Project management is part of the school curriculum from primary school onwards. Some great work being done by the IPMA in Germany to put project management onto the curriculum in primary schools. Really interesting. Andrew says, I dream that stakeholders would want to engage with me. Yeah, being there, I can associate with that one. Tim says, everyone to have the same work ethic as myself, from the project sponsor to the project team members. I'm sure some of us can feel your pain there, Tim. This is a great statement from David as well. I'm not going to be able to read all of them out. I'm just cherry picking here because an awful lot of comments coming back, which is fantastic. But David says, you know what I dream of? What I would really like is to be recognized as a real professional, like a doctor. That's really cool. That's a cool thing to dream of. Okay, I'm just going to pick up some of the realists' comments. Adam, as a realist, says that I'll still be chasing operations and contractors to do what's in the project plan and try to mitigate the slippage. Yep, that's that sounds like the view from a realist. David says that there'll be a recognition of project managers as functional experts in organizations. Carol says, as project managers become more credible, they're going to be more people who are not accidental project managers. That is a good view from a realist. Just a few comments from the critics. Ed comments, as a critic, there will no longer be project managers. That's an interesting challenge. I might touch on that challenge a bit later on, actually, Ed, because I think there's potentially something in there. David says we don't have enough people with the skills in the profession. Yeah, that could well be the case. And Anna says, I doubt that many large organizations are truly capable of effectively managing large projects or programs as a critic. Just one last comment from the critics. We'll be overloaded with bureaucracy. Yeah, the spelling of that's a real pain. When I do this as a session, Carl, then someone always says to me, and I'm whiteboarding these comments, and someone always comes up with the bureaucracy one. And it's a nightmare as a facilitator, because trying to spell bureaucracy correctly when you're whiteboarding in front of a room of 50 people is a real interesting challenge. But Carl says we'll be overloaded with bureaucracy, and the PMO will be a pure admin engine of forms and processes. So just some views from you as dreamers, realists, and critics. And they represent a pretty good cross-section of what we see as we go around the country doing these sessions and thinking about the future of the profession. What I wanted to do was just share my thoughts on the future of the profession, and I get to look across the whole dreamer, realist, critic piece and hopefully challenge you with some of the things that I think will be really important to us having a successful and long future. And I'm going to introduce the word change makers into this conversation, because I think that project managers will become the world's change makers. What do I mean by that? I think a change maker is an enabler of change. Someone who can give the authority or means to do something, to make it possible for someone to do something. And I think this is going to be incredibly important to the world in which we work and live. You see, I think there's a real danger out here that over the past 20, 30 years particularly, we've spent a lot of our effort and energy and ability as a profession creating, codifying, and distributing process. And it's not that process is a bad thing, it's a great thing, but if it doesn't lead to an outcome, then actually I don't think it delivers enough value. From a project manager's point of view, I don't think our challenge is in creating and codifying and managing successful processes. I think our challenge is all about enabling change that creates a real legacy and sustainable benefits. And that's why I think the role of a change maker, and I deliberately use the word separately to the word project manager, although I think this is where we need as a profession to start to look to build our capability. I think the role of a change maker is about creating that real legacy and not just becoming bound in process and becoming bound in the doctrines and the methodologies that we've created so far. You see, I don't think it matters which part of the world you work in or I work in or we live in or which role that we play in our work lives. Because if I'm in a private sector role, actually my competitive advantage is based on, it's built on, our ability as an organization to create, adopt and sustain change. If I can't do that as a private sector organization, someone will come along and produce my product more quickly, for less cost, somewhere else in the world, probably within 6 months of me bringing it to market. So fundamentally, my success is based on competitive advantage, and that competitive advantage is built on my ability to make change happen. What would it look like if I was in a public sector? Because we might say, oh, that's not relevant to me. I work in the NHS, I work in the hospital. Well, actually, I believe it's just as relevant, because our ability in the public sector to adapt to the world around us is fundamental to our success and our service delivery. In the NHS, one of the biggest challenges we're facing currently is an aging population and the different demands that brings upon the way we deliver services. So actually, in public sector, my service delivery and my success at service delivery is, again, built on, it's based on our ability to create, adopt and sustain change, to be change makers. And finally, in society at large, actually, I think our survival as a society is based on our ability to create, adopt and sustain change. The world is changing. Our society is changing. The demands of the next generations coming to our workplace, to our sport facility, to our society, are fundamentally different. The demands they're placing are fundamentally different to the demands we placed when we went to those places. So again, our survival as a society is based on our ability to create, adopt and sustain change. If we can't do those things as private sector, as public sector, as society, I think we will actually face some fundamental challenges in those roles. And I question whether anybody is better suited, better equipped to support the creation, adoption and sustaining of change in those environments than project management professionals. And that's really the question I want to pose and put out there to you, is when you look at the future of your profession, when you, maybe if you're organizing training in your organization, when you spend your training budget for project management, where are you going to spend it? Are you going to, and by the way, we're not a training company, just in case you thought that was a very blunt sales pitch. But if you spend your training budget for project management, where are you going to spend it? Because 80% of the budgets I see spent now just train on method. They don't actually train on creating sustainable change. And by the way, you can't change anyone. No one can change me. The only person who can change myself and my habits is me. But what you can do is you can influence me to change. And I think as project managers, we fundamentally have to move our focus from the structures of what we do, the processes that we deploy, to actually facilitating and enabling environments where people, societies, organizations change and sustain change to deliver and enjoy real legacy. Why do I think that's really important for us as a profession? Well, let's have a word from Brucey, shall we? He did a thing called the generation game, and I think we're in a generation game. There's a difference between first and second generation professions. First generation professions spend a lot of time capturing knowledge and setting up the rules and regulations. Engineering, finance. I come from a finance background. A lot of the last century and the early part of the last century was spent defining things like statements of standard accounting practice and GAAP and stuff like that. Latterly, the finance professionals and the finance profession has turned from just doing tick and bash audit and did you meet the rules to supporting strategic delivery, to supporting performance management, business balance scorecards, Kaplan and Norton, those sort of conversations came out of the finance professionals wanting to say it's not just about codifying the knowledge, it's about actually how do we use and apply that knowledge to improve our business or the world around us. And that's the challenge that I think exactly faces the profession. We spent a lot of time capturing knowledge, which is brilliant, and it's great stuff, and we absolutely have to have it. I'm not saying we shouldn't have prints, but how many of you have deployed prints straight out of the book in your organizations as it was written? And generally, the answer is very few. It's about what you do with that, how you apply that knowledge with your pragmatism, with your experience, to actually realize sustainable change. If we do not move from a first generation to a second generation profession, we will be left behind. And that's my second reason, because I think there's a land grab coming up. I think what's going to happen is the ability to deliver sustainable change in private sector, public sector, is going to become such a sought after commodity in the boardrooms of our organizations that we work in, that it will actually become incredibly attractive to other organizations who do similar things to us. This is a website snap that I took of the Institute of Change Management. And it's not meant to be prescriptive, but what I find really interesting is this organization uses language that is very similar to our project management language. Bottom right hand corner, a program, project or change manager should be appointed with clear responsibility to keep things moving and to orchestrate the process. In reality, I think if we are the best placed people to be the board representation, the engine room in our organizations that not deliver good process, but deliver sustainable change and real legacy. If, however, we as a profession do not take that opportunity and do not promote ourselves into that position, others will come and take its place, because it is going to become a very important and, I might add, lucrative market for organizations to be able to support. And we will find ourselves as a project management profession becoming separated. We'll find ourselves behind the game. And then, in the words of some of the critics that we've spoken to in that session, we will become irrelevant. So my challenge to you is, do you want to be a change maker? And if you were a change maker, what would you do differently today or tomorrow? Some of these things, we haven't got time to spend hours debating this, but some of these things you probably do already. But I'm just going to throw up two things that I think would make a difference in the projects that I'm involved in, if I was to approach them as change, as a change maker, rather than what I would regard as the typical approach of project management. First thing is to think about actually what we value and do as project managers. Forrester did this research 3 years ago now, and they ranked what, based on their surveys, they thought were the 10 key capabilities of next generation project managers. Well, this was 3 years ago, so that's you and me. We are the next generation project managers. And I look down that list, and I think, again, I'll come back to my training budget, how much of your project management professional development has been spent looking at these areas compared to how much of it has been spent looking at technical areas. I did a session a year ago with a large publishing house where we talked about the ideal project manager. And we did a big sort of, is a global PMO, we did a big whiteboard session talking about what were the attributes of the ideal, the project manager, the superman of project management. And 9 out of the 10 characteristics all fell into the interpersonal, what you might call soft skills category. And there was only 1 of the 10 ideal characteristics that actually fitted into a structured technical learning path. And the challenge, I think, for us as change makers is actually, what does your project change? Because most of the things that we do are directed towards changing the formal things we can identify. The systems, the policies, the procedures, the forms, the training. When we deploy change in our organization, so much of the effort and the work that we do in our projects is directed towards changing these tangible things. But to enable real legacy, I believe what we need to change is the stuff under the water. And like the iceberg, it's the biggest thing. Doesn't matter how good a system we put in place. Doesn't matter how pretty a building we build. It doesn't matter how great a railway we open. If nobody wants to use it, there is no sustainable change and there is no legacy. And actually, I think that's a challenge for us as project managers, because what it means is we need to focus as much energy on understanding what's below the water and how to influence that as we do about what understanding and influencing what's above the waterline. The other thing I would ask as a project manager, and the other thing I think a change maker might do differently, is where we focus. Any of you parents, when you're a parent and you're going on holiday, what's the one question that the little person in the back of the car asks incessantly during that journey? It's usually typified by words along the lines of, are we there yet? But yeah, generally in a higher pitched, more squealing voice that drives you absolutely mad. The thing is, though, as our stakeholder on that journey, is our child interested in the planning of how we're getting there? Are they interested in the route map? Are they interested in the process? Are they interested in all that detailed work that Dad, you did to work out which service stations we were going to stop and refuel at? Or actually, are they really interested in the outcome? Is their mindset as a key stakeholder in actually what they're going to do when they get to the beach, the fun they're going to have, the enduring memories, the legacy, the enjoyment? And I think that's a real challenge for us as project managers, because I think we can spend a lot of our time focusing on the journey, not the outcomes. I think a change maker focuses on the outcomes. One of the things that I do when I'm not doing this is rebuild things that start off looking a bit like that. That's one of the that van is in my workshop at the moment, and actually looks an awful lot worse than that because I've taken quite a few bits off it now. The thing for me is, with that project, if I focused on the state of that van as I was doing it and all the muck and rubbish and rust and horrible dirty things I have to do to it, I would never ever complete that project. But if my mindset is focused on the outcome, what it will look like, on my wife and I going for trips in it and weekends away and going and seeing the kids and stuff like that, I will have a far greater chance of completing the project, of going through all of the muck and bullets that I have to go through to get that project done. So as a change maker, I have to look at where I focus. As a project manager, I have to look at where I focus. And I think we need to spend a lot more time focusing on what the outcomes look like for our stakeholders and what they will actually get and enjoy from the legacy that we provide to them, rather than spending as much time perhaps as we do now focusing on the journey and the processes and structures. Fundamentally, I challenge us to think about, do we start with the end in mind? For me, project management delivers an output. It delivers. It's too easy to say, yep, I'm going to get you this thing and it's going to deliver on this day. Actually, change makers deliver a legacy. It's about the sustainable change that we make in our society, in our companies, in our organizations. So I wanted to just ask you, what do you want to be? Do you want to be safe hands project managers who, yeah, I can give you a Gantt chart, I can tell you what you need to do next, and I can tell you that there's a fair chance we'll deliver that piece of kit on that day? Or are you called to be something more than that? Are you called actually to be a profession that fundamentally affects the way our society works? And by that, I mean the organizations in it, private sector, public sector, the way we do life. Because the world around us is changing so rapidly. If as a society and as a species we cannot adapt, if we cannot become much, much more successful at adapting to, adopting and delivering sustainable change, I believe we will actually become extinct. And the last group of people or reptiles on this earth that weren't able to adapt did just that, and the dinosaurs vanished. I think that's just a real challenge for us as well. If as a profession we cannot step up to the plate and help the world around us understand how to embrace and sustain change, then we as a profession will vanish as well, and someone else will take our space. You may recognize this guy. He's fairly well known in the APM. He and I had a conversation last summer talking about this stuff, and I was not expecting the response I got. I thought, you know, this guy invented time, cost, quality, been around for a long time. I won't say quite since the pyramids were built, but been around for a long time. And we were having a conversation about the future role of the profession, and it was really interesting what he had to say. And He repeated something he'd said to me at the later on in the year at the conference, and this is what he said. If project management is the management of change, then the rest of management is the management of no change. And how exciting would that be? What he's saying is that our role as project management fundamentally is about managing change. We have the most exciting job and the most exciting opportunity on the planet, because the single most precipient thing that is going to happen in our world is change. We have the skills, we have the abilities, we have the tool set, and we have the opportunity. Will we take advantage of that opportunity remains to be seen. I'm going to wind up in a couple of minutes and we'll take some questions from people. Feel free to start pinging those through on the question session and the chat boxes. If you want to continue the debate about being a change maker, then there is a Twitter address and there's also a blog there. Really love to engage with you in that debate. One of the advantages of doing a webinar is because we can reach hundreds of people far more than we can with physical presentations. And I just have a passion for challenging you around what the future of the profession is and discussing and debating with you what the future of the profession is. So please engage with me. If you want my contact details, this slide deck, as I said earlier, will be circulated after the session. And we will, you can contact me through either of those organizations. If you're interested in change management or you're interested in implementing project control solutions, or broadly facilitating the delivery of change through the projects, programs, and portfolios that you work with, I'd love to have that conversation with you. I'm going to ask you really through this session to look at the world a little bit differently, to think about project management and think about the profession you're involved in a little bit differently. And just to give you an example of how that might change your perceptions, I'm just going to play a little video to finish with. And again, the talk track over this will be on the links when I send them through to you. But just watch this video and I'll talk over it for you and think about how you might change your perception of the way you look at project management. This is the end of publishing, and books are dead and boring. No longer can it be said that we like to read. My friends and I, we don't know why books feel in our hands. True, I don't follow trends. I know I want where I sit and catch more important than content. I have to tell you, my essential is all for your ideas. And it's just not true. I read a lot and I like that. You should know, I think I would have been served with the environment and society. What I really hope you get is you've got to open your eyes to my value. Of course, the person is what they are, I was wearing. Not that much what Gandhi did last century. I think it's unbelievable that you're actually listening to us. What's important to you is you'll find customers for your products. We'll think your job's done if we like your brand. We'll do it for you on Facebook, on mobiles, millions. Your market is dying. Don't think it's all going to survive. It is the end of the publishing industry as we know it. Unless you reverse how you see me. It is going to survive. Don't think that it's all dying. Your market is me and my friends on your mobiles, on Facebook. We'll do it for you. If we like your brand, your job's done. You'll think products for your customers. You'll find what's important to you is that you're actually listening to us. I think it's unbelievable that the industry don't really care all that much what they are wearing. Importance to me is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What I really hope you get is I've got you to be concerned with environment and sustainability. And you never think I don't care. I read a lot. I like learning. And it's just my attention span is too small for big ideas. I have to tell you, it's more important than aging. I know what I want when I see it, and I follow it. It's not true that we don't like the way books feel in our hands. Friends and I, we like to read. No longer can it be said that books are dead and boring, and this is the end of publishing. That video was done by a division, Dorian Kindersley, a division of Pearson, to help their sales team think about what was happening in their world and the changes that were happening in their world around digital publishing and the impact it would have on books. But I think it's a really interesting video to think about, actually, how do we look at the world a little differently? Why must we look at the world a little differently? From my perspective, I'm asking you to look at your profession and our profession, my profession, through fresh eyes. Fundamentally, I believe our world is not sustainable unless we can adapt to the pace of change. And I have to tell you, I think our profession is redundant if it cannot show and lead and facilitate in how to successfully adapt, adopt, and deliver change. I hope you found that interesting and challenging. And please look forward to interacting with you on the blog. The details are there again. And continue to send your questions through. And I'm just going to have a quick drink from a glass of water, and then I'll respond to some of those questions that have come through already. Okay, so one of the questions we've got is, do you think a good project manager should be able to successfully manage any project in any discipline, or will specialist knowledge always be relevant or required? Yeah, that's a really cool one. We actually have quite a bit of debate about that in the sessions that we do around this subject, because some of the critical comments that come through when people are being critical is that project management will be generic. And equally, some of the comments come through will say that project management will be specialist. So it's a bit of a split jury on that one. My personal view is that I think there will always be some elements of change specific to an industry or specific to a place where specialist knowledge will be useful to you. But equally, that's probably the 20% or the 10% that gives flavor to what you do. I think the 80% is often generic. My challenge and my interest is seeing what constitutes that 80%. And I think in the context of this conversation, the 80% needs to be rebalanced more towards the stuff that actually helps us to sustain or create sustainable change and help us to enable change in the places that we're working, as opposed to the 80% being about the methods that we apply. Alvaro asks, is one of the biggest challenges for the future of project management to deal with the economic crisis and its consequences? Yes, and would probably be my answer, because that's kind of into that societal change that I was talking about. I think that as a society, and as whether we talk about our world as being the country we live in, the continent we live in, the economic environment we live in, there is just so much changing. You know, if you looked at the finance collapse 2 or 3 years ago, no one obviously did predict it, and equally everyone struggled to come to terms with it. What I find interesting is, what is our role as a profession in coping with that? What do we bring to the party? One of the dreamers from an earlier session came up with a dream that says, you know what? I want a PM for PM. I want a project manager for Prime Minister, because that is the most influential role that I believe a project manager can have. And that is the place where we would start to address some of these big societal challenges. I've got a hoo-ha from Julian. So that's an official request, people. So for the benefit of Julian, can we do a team hoo-ha on three, please? 1, 2, 3, hoo-ha! Fantastic. Next question. From Bruce. How do you get this across to the financial people who run the organizations? I've got a degree of empathy with that, although I'm probably sit on both sides of that fence, Bruce, because I spent the early part of my career as one of those financial people. Oh no, what an admission to make. The challenge and the opportunity, I think, is in helping the finance guys to understand what's in it for them and what's in it for the organization. There's a lot of times when it may not be eminently obvious to them why they need to spend more money talking about the outcomes and bringing in the stakeholders, the user communities, really early on in a project, when actually they're more interested in spending money on the structural stuff around the project. The conversation I think you have to step into is the mutual purpose, the what's in it for me, because the finance guys and girls are fundamentally interested in return. If they cannot have a conversation about return on investment, what's the financial benefit, what's the benefit of this money I'm investing, then your project will be very short-lived. The return is only ever achieved when we have legacy, when we have enduring benefit. You know, you get zero benefit and zero financial return generally on the first day your project is implemented. Where your return accrues is in the year following the delivery of your project, through better efficiency, through increased turnovers and revenues. So I think that's some of the mutual purpose that we need to have with the finance people, which is to say, actually, this is the tangible benefit that you will get from taking an approach that is more long-term rather than just looking at the very structural project stuff. Thanks for all the hoo-has that are coming through on the on the comment sheet, the question sheet. Ian, what do you do with a project manager who says there is not a place for programs? I don't know. I'll open that one out. it's interesting. You know, when I started doing this back, 10, 12 years ago, we all talked about project management. It was probably only about 2006 we started talking about programs as such, although I know programs have been around a lot longer than that. Interestingly, it's only probably 2 or 3 years ago we started talking about portfolios, and we still have two completely different definitions of what portfolio management is, whether it's strategic selection or whether it's a management of a collection of projects. So there is something in the terminology. The conversation, I think, probably changes to one about project professionals as opposed to project managers or program managers. It's more about what is your role, what is the thing that you're trying to achieve, as opposed to the sort of the big debate around what my job title is. Okay. The question from Nina, how can we place ourselves as the leaders of change without alienating the other professions, especially the ITL professions? I'm not sure, Nina, what do you mean by ITL? Just ping me that one through and I'll answer the question from my understanding anyway. That's interesting. There are change management professionals out there. I'm not saying that they're not doing a good job. I'm not saying that they shouldn't be out there. I guess what I'm saying is, in my experience, the best equipped community I've come across to deliver sustainable change has been those project professionals that I've met and spoken to. So it's not so much, it's not so much one-upmanship per se, as actually trying to think about who has the best skills and is best placed. I think the one thing I do believe, though, is as project managers and as project professionals, we have an absolute duty to take our skills and to use them to deliver sustainable change. If we don't do that, then the other professionals will step into that space, will take that ground from us, and will actually relegate us more to being the collectors of specialist knowledge. James asks, would you recommend an MSP Managing Successful Programs course or Prince 2 course, given that MSP appears to supersede Prince 2 in your timeline? It does in the timeline, but I probably answered that a little bit when I said that, you know, there was, in my experience in the project profession, there's been a sort of a sequence of conversations as we've gradually defined and unpacked our profession, and we started with projects, then we talked about programs, now we're talking about portfolios. I don't think that I would recommend either course above the other. I would say it's relevant to the role that you're doing. The course I would recommend to everyone is that you start to think more about how you interact with the stakeholders around you, and particularly how you have conversations around facilitating, encouraging, enabling change. Because that's a really tough conversation to have. As I said earlier, no one can change me. If I go in as a project manager, or a project manager comes to me and says, we're delivering this new system and you will change the way you work. Well, I can guarantee you one thing I will not do, and that is change the way I work just because you've told me I have to. If you can influence me to understand why that would benefit me and what it would benefit, it would bring to the organization I work in, then I might well change. And I think that's the sort of conversation and that's the sort of education that we need to see more of in our industry. Andrew asks, when a project is complete, does a PM really let go? That's really interesting. Really interesting. You see, again, part of the way we've defined this profession is that the project manager turns the lights off and closes the door on the day the project delivers. I know that's not strictly true, but you know, we talk a lot about lessons learned and project closure and that, but how much effort do you really see on your average project put into project closure and lessons learned? I actually think a project manager should have a much longer lifespan in a project, because they need to see the change being delivered. They need to see the benefits being accrued, and that's actually quite a different remit for us. The other thing I would say, which is kind of aligned to that, is the project, the opposite, and it's about the project sponsor. I would say when a project starts, does the project sponsor really disappear? Because I think on a lot of projects they do. Once the project's got its budget, it's initiated, it's handing over to a project manager, you hear the door slam, exit stage left, the project sponsor. I'd actually like to see a lot more longevity for the project sponsor, so they actually are responsible for the delivery of the benefit. And they actually take on a lot more responsibility for longevity in this conversation. Okay, just one more question. How do you see, and this is from Eric, how do you see the future of project management affecting the importance of PRINCE2, PMP, and the different credentials and that individuals have? Good one there, Eric. I think the challenge with the credentials is a lot of our credentials are focused on our ability to learn information and regurgitate it in a structured manner. Now, at a level, we have to be able to do that until we come up with a better way of learning and assessing learning. But for me, it's only part of the story. One of the things I quite like about the RPP, the Registered Project Professional, that APM has been doing, and believe me, this isn't an APM advert, but one of the things I genuinely quite like about it is it puts so much more emphasis on actually what have you done rather than what have you learned. So in terms of the credentials, I think the credentials will always have to be there. But when I appoint a project manager in my organization, or when I appoint a project manager in some of the trusts that I work with in the charitable sector, what I'm actually looking for is someone who's got the ability and the passion and the knowledge and the understanding and the experience potentially to actually deliver the sustainable changes that we're looking for as a result of that project. Yes, I need them to be able to do some due diligence along the way. If they cannot give me a structured set of tasks that might be captured in a plan or something else along that line, then they will not engender the confidence in me that they can deliver those sustainable changes. But I have to look beyond the ability to sit exams. Someone I talked to once had a really interesting view, and they said when they were looking to recruit someone, do you look for character or competency? Because so much of our recruitment is based on competency, which is judged by exam success and credentials. actually I have a very strong view that when I recruit someone into my business, I am looking as much, if not more, at their character. Because if they've got the right character, then they can probably do most of the things I need them to do, or they are self-aware enough to know where their weaknesses are, admit to them, and get the right skills in place. Often I see people who have incredible paper competency, but do not have the character that I need to deliver the projects that I work on and to work with the stakeholders that I work with. So I'm probably going to wrap it up there because we are now at 5:25. For those of you who are interested in the conversations we've had, please pick up some of those contact details, ping me on the blog or ping me an email and we can continue this chat. There's been nearly 100 of you on this call over the 120 we peaked at, my assistant tells me. Thanks, Colin. It's been a really interesting conversation, some great feedback on the from the dreamer realist and the critic point of view. So hope to be able to engage with you at some stage soon. Please contact me. Feel free to contact me, ask questions, make comments on the blog, tweet about it. Awesome. The more we can move this conversation forward and raise the profile of the future of our profession, then I think the better placed we will be to support the needs of our society and to make sure we don't become redundant as a profession. So my name's Paul Major. Thank you for joining me this afternoon and for joining in this conversation. And I look forward to meeting you at an event in the future. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.